I hope you're having a great day. I hope you had a great weekend as well. Today I want to talk about, we keep talking about things that are great for your health, lifestyle changes that you should make that are great for your health. But today I want to talk about, you know, people who overdo health, people who have become so health obsessed that they do certain things which, yes, are healthy for us. But what happens when we overdo these things? What happens when we overdo health? It can harm us. And a lot of it is harming people already. So I have a list of things which are healthy for us, but at the same time, if we overdo it, if we push it to extremes, it can have a negative impact on us and it can harm our health. The number one thing is the practice of green juices. It's become a fad. Everyone says, I wake up in the morning, I had a green juice, I had a green juice, I had a green juice. Please understand, okay? Number one, there's nothing wrong with a green juice. What's wrong with a green juice is, if it's not organically grown, please understand that green leafy vegetables are the most sprayed vegetables. You're drinking a glass of pesticides and chemicals. Number two, a lot of them, like spinach, are rich in oxalates. Some people juice kale. Some people put broccoli in. They do all of these things, which even if you have a thyroid problem, it's going to make your thyroid worse. And there are so many people out there living without even knowing that they have a thyroid problem. That's number two with a green juice. Number three, it is so much of fiber, and too much of fiber is not good for you. It is a myth that you need more fiber in the human body. If we have a balanced meal, we have our two or three fruits a day, our nuts, our seeds, our lentils, our whole grains, we have enough of fiber to produce a good bowel movement, to feed our friendly bacteria in our gut and our microbiome, and to even look after cholesterol. Because, you know, a fiber has a mechanical process that gets through our system, pulling out excess cholesterol from our body. But when we overdo it with fiber, you can have IBS, you can have inflammation in your colon, it can aggravate your colitis problems, it can cause gut problems as well, it can cause you to bloat, it can cause you to be acidic and all of that stuff. Everything in moderation. So please understand, just because it becomes a fad, it doesn't mean you go on drinking green juices. Like if I have to look at two people, person A drinking the green juice and person B having a healthy diet with a little bit of green vegetables and salad before their meals, there is no data showing that the person having the green juice is healthier than the person who's not doing that. That's number one, green juice. Number two, I spoke about it in point number one. Do not overdo it with fiber. There are people who take Isabgul and psyllium husk and keep having it before their meals so that they feel full and they don't eat too much of it. Please understand, excess fiber will irritate your gut lining. It can also lead to a leaky gut and autoimmune disorders. Examples of autoimmune disorders: a Hashimoto's thyroid, multiple sclerosis. You can have rheumatoid arthritis, you can have lupus, you can have so many issues, including alopecia, hair fall, bad skin on your face and everything else, because you have too much of fiber, your gut is sensitive, it starts inflaming your gut, and you have a problem of an autoimmune disorder. A no-carb diet, low-carb, there's a lot of magic in low-carb. There is no magic in no-carb. Please understand that. Of course, if you've put yourself into a bucket of keto diet, you know, you need to calculate the amount of carbohydrates, but there are so many people who go off carbs completely. The first thing that changes, they start getting snappy, frustrated, angry, all of these issues. It affects their mood. Number two, okay, nature has given us foods that contain carbohydrates. Okay, we have enzymes in our body that break down carbohydrates. If carbohydrates were not required, we wouldn't have the enzymes to break it down. We wouldn't produce the digestive enzymes to break it down. Carbohydrates break down into energy. The argument is so does protein and so does fat, but they all have different functions. So please understand, going no carb, you will cripple your metabolism. There are good carbs and there are bad carbs. You need it according to the kind of work that you do. So athletes wouldn't need carbs if they didn't need energy. So please understand that if you're training heavy, you go to the gym, you're lifting weights, you're doing all of that stuff, you need carbohydrates in the right quantity. It could be low carb. And the right quality of carbohydrates, extremely important. We have people who go off no carb, they lose 4 kilos, 5 kilos, 6 kilos. They come back looking 10 years older. Their skin is in a mess. They've broken down into acne. And mainly, they're unhappy. They feel deprived. Any diet that psychologically affects you will lead to depression at some point or the other. Good health results in you feeling good. Lose weight and feel good in your body and in your mind. Losing weight but feeling deprived and psychologically depressed, that is harming your body. Keto diets. I have no issues with keto diets at all. It's a fantastic diet if you are doing it the right way. One in two people I meet are doing it the wrong way. You need to calculate your carbohydrates. Most people get that calculation wrong. Two, it doesn't mean, keto doesn't mean that you eat as much of fat as you want to. It doesn't mean that you eat as much of protein as you want to. Medically, when you make a keto diet, all of these aspects are calculated gram to gram. Most people don't do that. I see people putting spoons of coconut oil in their coffee, spoons of ghee in their coffee, eating cubes of cheese at lunch, and they're happy and getting zero results, but they think I'm doing the keto diet. So if you're doing it, do it the right way. Most people do it the wrong way and it harms them. Okay, sleep. Okay, we know sleep's good for us, but some people sleep for 10, 11, 12 hours because they're depressed. They go through all of these issues. Please understand, when you sleep longer than required, it is also bad for your health. There are certain functions that are activated when we're in awake mode, and there are certain which are deactivated when we're still in our sleep mode. So please understand, okay, you need to train your body to sleep right, and then everyone understands that my body does best with 7 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours, or 9 hours. So too much of sleep is also bad for you. Exercise, over-exercising, punishing your body with exercise is also harmful for you. Understand your body's made up of tissues, muscles, and bones, wear and tear. A muscle can regrow and repair itself. A bone cannot do that. So a lot of people in their prime punish themselves with exercise and they have problems as they age. Athletes are paid a lot of money because of the risk that comes along with the game and their training. So please understand that. And most people training don't even have the right nutrition to back it up. That's why they get more and more injured. By you getting more and more injured, you need to question your training, because your training should make you healthier and stronger. It shouldn't make you sicker and more injured. So please understand that if you're training hard, you eat accordingly. You up your protein, your fats, your supplements, everything that you're doing. And exercise also requires recovery. Today, people have made 6 out of 7 days a workout and they think they're doing something great. Please let's understand that even pro athletes don't do that. They eat, they sleep, they train, they recover, and they do it again. They have way more recovery than you and me. So if you're training hard, you got to sleep hard, you got to recover hard. If you're training hard every single day in the gym, after a while, it is going to harm you. More exercise, more recovery. More exercise, more sleep. More exercise, more accurate nutrition, and then it doesn't harm you. Exercising and running with low vitamin B12 levels and low vitamin D3 levels is disastrous to your health. Half the people running marathons have low D3 levels. You're only messing up your health for now and in the future. Your bone density and everything to do with that. You're training for a marathon, train like a professional. Get your blood work done, make sure your levels are in place, make sure you're eating the right way, and all of that stuff. Please put that in place. Okay, the right amount of D3 levels and the right amount of B12 levels is extremely important for your training. Overdoing it with supplements. Just because a supplement is well advertised and it tells you 10 benefits that basically make you think, wow, I need to have this. There are so many people overdoing supplements. Please understand a supplement is needed if you have a deficiency. Okay, if you have a gap in your diet that a supplement can fill. But just because it sounds good doesn't mean you do it. It's as simple as that. Please understand that more supplements doesn't mean you are healthier. But more supplements which are unnecessary is destroying your health. Fruit platters. Yes, fruits are healthy if consumed in the right quantity. Sometimes you see people at breakfast tables with a fruit platter this big. They're eating almost 5 to 6 different fruits at one serving. That's not good for you. Please understand, there will be too much of fructose malabsorption in your gut, irritation to your gut, a fluctuation in your blood sugar levels. Nature's given you an apple. That's one serving. You eat an apple. You eat a small portion of strawberries, a small portion of water. Higher. Just because you eat more fruit doesn't mean you are going to be healthier. Have 5 fruits in a day if you want, but keep a gap between them. Space it out. Your stomach's this small. The enzymes that you produce will be enough for 1 fruit, not for 5 fruits. So while we're on the topic of fruits, let's talk about juices as well. Some people think drinking fruit juices throughout the day is something healthy for them. It's robbing you of your health. It's not adding any health at all. A lot of parents give their kids bottles of juice and Tropicana and say, I don't give my children aerated drinks. You're not doing them any better by giving them packaged fruit juices or homemade fruit juices as well. Fruit juices has its places in people who are very sick. They need to be on a soft diet, all of that stuff. Fasting. Fasting's become the new fad. It's great for you if you do it the right way. Now, people have made it a competition. I'm fasting for 72 hours, 46 hours, 50 hours. What's your... They don't even know why they're doing it. They're doing it because everyone else is doing it. Understand, when we've learned the beauty of fasting from religions. Every single religion talks about fasting. It's not done and crammed into your life every single day. Ramadan happens at one part of the year. Lent happens at one part in the year. Fasting happens according to the moon cycles. One day or 2 days or 11 days. But here we are trying to beat ourselves with fasting. And if we can't do it, we start getting demotivated. We start getting depressed and stuff like that. Treat fasting as something which is sacred. Do your 12-hour circadian fast from sunset to sunrise. That's what keeps discipline in fasting. Certain days, select 2 days in a week where you may want to do a 16 or 18-hour fast. Select one day every 2 weeks or every 15 days where you may want to do a 24-hour fast. But do it with logic. Don't just try to make it a fad and do it and do it and feel unhappy at the end of it. But at the same time, 12, 13, 14 hours makes you feel great. Your energy levels are fine. You're not feeling deprived. Go ahead and do it. But for everyone else who's trying to cram it as a fad in their lifestyle, that's absolutely bad. And the last thing is spiritual fads. Spirituality has also become a fad. I have people who say, I'm moving from a chanting class to a meditation class. All they're doing through the day is classes after classes. And when I check on their stress levels and anxiety, it's still at the highest. You have a spiritual path, but please understand, practice what you learn. If you're just doing class after class and not practicing what meditation or spirituality teaches you, which is acceptance and letting go, your life's not getting better at all. In fact, you're going to get more and more frustrated. People, I go for Vipassana every 3 months, but yet I'm stressed, yet I'm anxious, yet I'm whatever. What did Vipassana teach you? To let go, to treat everything in equilibrium. But you're not doing that. You're sitting there for 10 days and coming back without practicing what the beautiful technique has taught you. Chanting and chanting and chanting and chanting, and then you move into life, into your normal day, and you're unable to accept things, you're unable to let go of things. So these are things which you overdo. After a while, it frustrates you. And you think and you give up, I'm doing so much for my health, but I have absolutely no improvement. Health is simple. Your body is designed to look after you. Figure out what are those things that your body needs to look after you, and only give your body that. Extremes are unnecessary. The healthiest and the fittest people in the world do not have extreme measures to get fit and to stay fit. They do the simplest things every day, consistently, with discipline and no extremes at all. And that's exactly what you and I should be doing as well. Have a great day, everyone. Until next time, eat smart, move more, sleep right, and breathe deep.